Okay, guys, we left off Montag being sick, having a discussion with Mildred, and she is really unconcerned, really, about his distress and sickness and everything. So we're going to just skip a couple pages and go down to page 51. And same in paper text as your digital text, which you see on the screen. So Beatty shows up now, and they're going to have a discussion, and this is going to give us important starting of the sort of background context to the whole history of the fireman's profession that Beatty's going to give. How did the firemen form? And also the cultural, we'll call it the cultural seedbed for this totalitarianism. So, what gave rise to the people being willing or not having a revolution to go against the government who took this control and started having book burnings and shortening texts and things like that. So Beatty's actually going to give us some really important information in this section where he shows up at Montag's house. So Beatty's shown up at Montag's. He knows Montag is something's off with him. Well, said Beatty, take the night off. He examined his eternal matchbox, the lid of which said guaranteed 1 million lights in this igniter, and began to strike the chemical match abstractedly. Blow out, strike, speak a few words, blow out. He looked at the flame he blew, he looked at the smoke. When will you be well? Tomorrow, maybe the next day, first of the week. Beatty puffed his pipe. Every fireman sooner or later hits this. They only need understanding to know how the wheels run, need to know the history of our profession. Notice that, the history of our profession. They don't feed it to rookies like they used to. Damn shame. Puff. Only fire chiefs remember it now. Puff. I'll let you in on it. All right, so Beatty is saying only the people in charge, only the higher up people get to know the secret history, the backdrop of the fireman's profession, how this all got started. But he says every fireman has this issue that Montag's having sooner or later. Mildred fidgeted. Beatty took a full minute to settle himself in, think back for what he wanted to say. When did it all start, you asked, this job of ours? How did it come about? Where? When? Well, I'd say it really got started around about a thing called the Civil War. Even though our rule book claims it was founded earlier, the fact is we didn't get along well until photography came into its own. Then motion pictures in the early 20th century, radio, television. Things began to have mass. Oh, notice first thing Beatty brings up, okay, the advent of new technology. New technologies. Advent means the start, the beginning, the launch. Okay, advent is the start or the beginning of these new technologies. And what do we have? Photography and radio and TV. Okay. Motion pictures, sorry, photography, then film, motion pictures, then radio, then TV. So photography leads to film. And the other two. And what does he call these? These are forms of mass media. So mass media refers to the scale or the scope. Okay, how far, how widespread can it be, global maybe, and how many people can be reached through those technologies. Montag sat in bed, not moving. And because they had mass, they became simpler, said Beattie. Once, books appealed to a few people here, there, everywhere. They could afford to be different. The world was roomy. But then the world got full of eyes and elbows and mouths, double, triple, quadruple population. Films and radios, magazines, books leveled down to a sort of paste pudding norm. Do you follow me? All right. What's going on here? So, before there was room in the world, but then it got full. So we have an issue of overpopulation. Why is that going to lead to media getting simplified when he says they were leveled down to a sort of paste pudding form, norm? Okay. This means dumbed down. It's dumbed down, oversimplified. What's the connection between overpopulation and oversimplification, making things like Mildred's TV shows? Do you follow me? I think so. Beattie peered at the smoke pattern he had put out on the air. Picture it, 19th century man with his horses, dogs, carts, slow motion. Then in the 20th century, speed up your camera. Books cut shorter. Condensations, digests, tabloids, everything boils down to a gag, a snap ending. Snap ending, Mildred nodded. Classics cut to 15-minute radio shows, then cut again to fill a 2-minute book column, winding up at last as a 10 or 12-line dictionary resume. I exaggerate, of course. The dictionaries were for reference, but many were those whose sole knowledge of Hamlet, you know the title certainly, Montague, it is probably only a faint rumor of a title to you, Mrs. Montague, whose sole knowledge, as I say, of Hamlet was a one-page digest in a book that claimed, "Now at least you can read all the classics. Keep up with your neighbors." Do you see? Out of the nursery, into the college, and back to the nursery. There's your intellectual pattern for the past 5 centuries or more. So apparently, this society has been going on for hundreds of years. Okay, we don't know the exact date. And what happened? Everything got shortened. Okay, simplified and reduced. So this whole process leads to faster plus more simple media, art, literature. And so it requires less critical thinking, less intelligence, less critical thinking to read it. It also reduces history. It oversimplifies history and reality and language. Because, for example, pardon me, well, he's talking about Hamlet. Who's Hamlet by, right? Well, that's Shakespeare. Well, to read Shakespeare, that's 400 years old. For us, it's written in a different English vernacular, a different English kind of dialect, that requires a different understanding of history. We need to know the culture and how they use words and what are the different words that they use that we don't use anymore, like thee and thou, and so on. Mildred arose and began to move around the room, picking things up and putting them down. Beatty ignored her and continued. Notice Mildred. She's fidgety. She can't focus. She can't follow the conversation. He's beginning a complex historical discussion, and she's just like, can't even sit still. Because her brain has become short and simplified and reduced because she's so addicted to the mass media, which is simple. She's become like what she consumes. Speed up the film montage, quick. Click, pick, look, eye, now, flick, here, there, swift pace, up, down, in, out, why, how, who, what, where, eh? Bang, smack, wallop, bing, bong, boom. Digest, 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 digest. Politics, one column, two sentences, a headline, then, in midair, all vanishes. Whirl man's mind around about so fast under the pumping hands of publishers, exploiters, broadcasters, that the centrifuge flings off all unnecessary time-wasting thought. All right. Notice how the style of this paragraph mimics and resembles the content. This is how media became. Short, fast, instant, simple, quick words, entertainment factor, boom. So Beatty is very intelligent. He knows what he's talking about. He's not stupid. He's not brainwashed. He knows how this developed. He's giving us an important view into the past here. Mildred smoothed the bedclothes. Montague felt his heart jump and jump again as she patted his pillow. Right now, she was pulling at his shoulder, trying to get him to move so she could take the pillow out and fix it nicely and put it back and perhaps cry out and stare or simply reach down her hand and say, "What's this?" and hold up the hidden book with touching innocence. So Montague had a book out before Beatty came, and he's hiding it under the pillow right now. Beatty continues. Now we look at institutions changed and society changed. School is shortened, discipline relaxed, philosophies, histories, language dropped, English and spelling gradually neglected, finally almost completely ignored. Life is immediate, the job counts, pleasure lies all about after work. Why learn anything save pressing buttons, pulling switches, fitting nuts and bolts? All right. What happened? Pleasure became the focus and work, just making money. Languages, history, philosophy, anything that was more complicated got dropped. Let me fix your pillow, said Mildred. No, whispered Montague. The zipper displaces the button, and a man lacks just that much time to think while dressing at dawn. A philosophical hour and thus a melancholy hour. Mildred said, "Here, get away," said Montague. Life becomes one big pratfall. Montague, everything bang, boff, and wow. Wow, said Mildred, yanking at the pillow. For God's sake, let me be," cried Montague passionately. Beatty opened his eyes wide. Mildred's hand had frozen behind the pillow. Her fingers were tracing the book's outline as the shape became familiar. Her face looked surprised and then stunned. Her mouth opened to ask a question. Empty the theater save for clowns and furnish the rooms with glass walls and pretty colors running up and down the walls like confetti or blood or sherry or sauterne. You like baseball, don't you, Montague? Baseball's a fine game. All right, so what did they do? They got all the movie theaters in the houses now. Glass walls, big screens, parlor walls, like Mildred is addicted to. All right, we'll keep going with this section of the important cultural background that Beatty gives us in this next video. Thanks.